Science at the University of Sydney, and it's my pleasure to welcome you all to the Sydney Science Forum this evening, and also to introduce Professor Dietmar Müller. Before doing so, I'd like to acknowledge and pay respect to the traditional owners of the land on which we meet, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. It is upon their ancestral lands that the University of Sydney is built. As we share our knowledge, teaching, learning and research practices within this university, may we also pay respect to the knowledge embedded forever within the Aboriginal custodianship of country. So, as I said, it's my pleasure to introduce the speaker for this evening, Professor Dietmar Müller. Professor Dietmar Müller is Director of the ARC based in Genesis Hub and the Sydney Informatics Hub at the University of Sydney. Both of these projects provide software and services to researchers, including world-class computational and storage infrastructure, software tools, data analytics, and visualization services to enable a broad range of approaches to informatics. Professor Dietmar Müller joined the University of Sydney in 1993. Since that time, he's established the Earthbyte e-Research Group with the aim of geodata synthesis through space and time, assimilating the wealth of disparate geological and geophysical data into a four-dimensional Earth model and connecting solid Earth to surface processes. Professor Müller's recent career highlights include being awarded one of four Vice Chancellor's Awards for Outstanding Research in 2016, and this year he was elected a Fellow of the Australian Academy of Science. I now invite Professor Müller to the stage to impart The World Builders, Creating an Experimental Planet.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here, and it's great to see such a large audience interested in building an experimental planet. And so today, I'll introduce you to the ingredients that it takes to build an experimental planet. And these ingredients will be applied on the computer, not in a kitchen stove, and not involving eggs, butter, and earthquake, as on the left-hand side here. And so hopefully we'll be able to do a better than a half-baked job today. Now, why would we want to build an experimental planet? So we're trying to understand how the Earth works. We're trying to understand how we can predict possible future paths of the Earth. We're trying to understand prediction of natural hazards like earthquakes and volcanic eruptions. We're trying to find out where we can find precious minerals that we need to build the next generation renewable energy infrastructures, or that we also need to build things like iPhones, for example. Now, in order to do that, we have to understand how the Earth works. We need to understand how we can actually observe the Earth back through time and into the future. That's, of course, something that we cannot observe directly, so we depend on computer models to do that. So we need a virtual Earth to enable travel in time and relative dimension in space, which is, of course, something that Doctor Who has done since 1963. Okay, understanding Earth evolution, we want to know how deep Earth processes are connected to surface processes. We'd also like to know how we can use the geological record of paleogeographic change, alternations between ice house and greenhouse climates, and biological evolution to predict the future. And as geologists, we try to read the record of the rocks, and generally we compile a lot of data, and ultimately we draw a cartoon as we gaze back through an imaginary landscape of dinosaurs grazing under palm trees, comets hitting the Earth, and large volcanoes erupting in the geological past. So what we'd really like to do is turn these geological stories into a physical understanding of how the Earth actually works. And for this, we need an experimental planet on the computer. Now, one aspect that I particularly want to focus on today is topography. Everybody understands topography, especially the rock climbers amongst you. Here's a great shot from Point Perpendicular, Jervis Bay. Some of you might have visited. Of course, topography on Earth is a consequence of plate tectonics. If you were to visit a planet with our plate tectonics, like Venus or Mars, it would look a hell of a lot flatter than Earth. And so this topography that plate tectonics creates, it helps to create the geo-ecosystems that ultimately provide the conditions for human settlement. They provide conditions for forming sedimentary basins that contain groundwater and other resources, modulate sea level and coastal processes, and ultimately climate through mountain building. So we are going to try to understand what actually drives topography through time. Now, many of you would have seen images like this one, impressive images of the Swiss Alps. Some of you might have been there, that generated by what we call tectonic topography. The Swiss Alps are the product of the African plate colliding with the European plate, and there are lots of marine sediments that were originally flat-lying on the seafloor in an ocean basin called the Tethys that no longer exists. They were all shoved up and folded, as you see very impressively on the right-hand side here. And so there, that's the sort of mountainous topography that we get excited by. Now, in Australia, we have mountains as well, but they are very different. This is a place that I'm sure many of you have visited, the Blue Mountains. Many of you might have even taken a picture, very similar to this one, a view of the Three Sisters. And here, we have a mountain chain, even though not as tall as the Swiss Alps. It's, they're the best mountains we've got in Australia, but they're strikingly different because you see this flat layer cake layering of the sediments. These are all river sediments that were once deposited in the Sydney Basin long before the Eastern Highlands existed. So the question that we are asking ourselves is, well, we understand quite well how the Swiss Alps came into being, but why do the Eastern Highlands exist? Here's a bird's eye view of the Eastern Highlands from a vantage point above the southern Tasman Sea. You see they're quite extensive. And the question is, well, why are they there? There's no evidence for collision or folding. Now, if we go one step further back in time, many of us might look at today's topography and think, oh, it's probably always looked like this, but nothing can be further from the truth. If we look at Australia a mere 100 or 110 million years ago, it would look very, very different. So this is a paleogeographic map that was constructed based on the variety of geological data that indicate that at this time, Eastern Australia was covered by a shallow inland sea that was inhabited by maritime dinosaurs like these ichthyosaurs and others. And the Eastern Highlands didn't exist at all. The highlands on this depiction are indicated by these light and dark brown areas, and so we only had a few patchy elevated areas. And the highest portion of Australia at this time was in fact Western Australia, very different to the topography that we are used to today. Now, interestingly, the idea that an inland sea might exist in Australia also occurred to the early settlers of Australia. So this is a map by Thomas Malson from 1831. And the early settlers, of course, noticed that there are a number of rivers flowing to the west from the Blue Mountains and Snowy Mountains. And they thought, well, perhaps these rivers all drain into an inland sea that is perhaps connected to a huge river system like the Australian Amazon River that drains into the Indian Ocean off the Northwest Shelf. And they cheerfully named the two halves of Australia that are separated by this imaginary river system, Australindia and Anglicania. Luckily, those terms didn't stick. But the idea that this vast inland sea might exist mesmerized the early settlers of Australia. And I'm talking here about the early Western white settlers, of course, because of course Australia has had a population who were definitely quite aware that there was no large inland sea there, but the colonists weren't aware of that. And so they started exploring the interior of Australia, and Sturt was one of the first ones, and he ventured out in two expeditions around 1828 to 1830, and explored the river systems in the south east of Australia here in the search for this great inland sea. And to his great disappointment, he found that the Lachlan and the Murrumbidgee River all drain into the Murray River, and and when he had finally reached the mouth of the Murray River, where he named Lake Alexandrina, he found that it was a maze of sandbars and embayments that were not useful for shipping. So he was very disappointed, and so he went back home and started another expedition in 1844, about which this book was written. During this expedition, he ventured farther north to finally find this inland sea, but instead, all he found was a stony desert. And at least, lucky for him, the stony desert was named after him, and is now known as the Sturt Stony Desert. Now, a historian once said about him that he was a man who was nearly always in the wrong place at the wrong time. That statement was partly made because he was about 3 days late arriving in Europe for the Battle of Waterloo. Now, I think he was probably actually quite in the right place, and he was quite lucky that he didn't arrive a few days earlier. You know? But he didn't think so at the time. But he was definitely in the wrong place at the wrong time for discovering this inland sea, because he was about 100 million years too late, sadly for him. So if he had only known that there was in fact an inland sea that had once existed. So here on the left-hand side, we are juxtaposing now the two paleogeographic reconstructions based on geological data. So one from 110 and one from 70 million years ago. And you see, a mere 40 million years later, our inland sea had disappeared, had been replaced by a bunch of rivers and river sediments that are shown in yellow here, and the eastern highlands had now appeared. And of course, what interests us is what drives these huge changes in topography and landscape through time. And an idea that's been developed over the last 10 to 15 years is that there's a force called, that there's a process called dynamic topography, a force that's very deep seated in the Earth, where slow churning currents of convection in the deep Earth might push up or draw down the surface of the Earth, where the continents end up moving over this convecting soup like a wobble board. Right? Now, we're going to now try to see how we can build an experimental Earth to understand how this process might work. And we'll start with just looking at how plate tectonics works. So there's a cross-section through a typical plate tectonic system here that might be located somewhere in the eastern Pacific, where we have seafloor spreading going on, where two plates diverge from each other, new ocean crust being created at the mid-ocean ridge. And for all this divergence, there has to be convergence somewhere else. Of course, that happens along these subduction zones, where old oceanic crust is being recycled back into the deep mantle. And so it will ultimately fall all the way down to the Earth's core. Right? And this system is merely the surface expression of a much larger system that also involves the Earth's mantle underneath. So if we now look at the cross-section of the Earth here on the left-hand side, so we have the inner and the outer core in bright red. The Earth's mantle is the material that's labeled as rock here, the yellow and the orange material between the thin eggshell-like plates at the surface of the Earth and the core down the boundary is at about 2,900 kilometers depth. It's the coupling between the plates and this slowly churning mantle that ultimately drives this great engine of plate tectonics. So as we can see on the right-hand side here, there's an animation that was created by one of our PhD students, Maëlys Arnaud, and so she's turned this into her own experimental planet, where all these blue snake-like elements are the subducting pieces of oceanic crust that are subducted, deform in the mantle, and ultimately make their way down all the way to the core mantle boundary, which is shown here. And the red chimney-like components here are mantle plumes. They're cylindrical upwellings of hot material that make it all the way from the core to the surface to ultimately generate volcanic eruptions. So we're going to try to understand how we can model the system. And what ultimately drives it is the fact that the Earth's core is about 6,000 degrees hot, same as the surface of the Sun. So the Earth is still losing heat from its original accretion, And it's also generating heat within the mantle, where we have radioactive elements that are still decaying, distributed throughout the entire mantle. And the most efficient mode to get rid of all this heat is, of course, convection. And so the mantle, if we could go down there, like is depicted in the famous movie The Core, one of my favorite movies, then if we could go down there, it's not that easy, unfortunately, if we could hit this material with a hammer, it would look like a rock to us. But over geological time, it actually very slowly convects, like is shown in this animation on the right-hand side. And so the first component of our experimental plan that we need to build is we need to model plate tectonics. And we do this with a software called the G-Plate software that has now been developed for nearly 1.5 decades. And John Cannon, who's in the audience here, and Michael Chen, I'm not sure whether Michael's here, they are the two main developers of the software. And there's others involved as well, a colleague from the Norwegian Geological Survey, and Simon Williams, the postdoc, who's also made large contributions to it. And here's an animation shown on the left-hand side by Sabin Zahirovich that shows how the supercontinent Pangaea broke up 200 million years ago and dispersed until the present day. Now, this software is not only used for actually modeling how the Earth works for research purposes, but it's also used in outreach, and particularly for the Magic Planet that's set up in the foyer. We have a look at this later. This G-Plate software is actually used in over 90% of all countries on Earth, so it's quite a large fan club right across the Earth. But we became curious about the countries that are in fact not using G-Plates. And so that brought me to this map here, where those countries that have never downloaded G-Plates or never visited our G-Plates web portal are indicated by these red arrows. And interestingly, one of them is North Korea, not a fan of G-Plates. I asked myself, well, why is that? You know, why are they not using G-Plates? And I ran across the answer on the internet. And this is a news piece from 2015 that shows North Korean state media footage showing Kim Jong-un standing before his generals and his own time machine that can defy space and time. And so this is obviously the reason why he doesn't need any other experimental plan. And of course, he has promised to transport the United States back to the 1950s. Which is apparently the worst period that you can be transported back into, according to the North Koreans. Not sure why. The next ingredient of our experimental planet, we need to model the Earth mantle. And so that's actually more involved than modeling the movement of the plates at the top. So for this, we use another free open source software. It's called CIPCOMS, the California Institute of Technology Community Code. And so here's Mike Gunns, our longtime collaborator at Caltech, shown in his natural habitat, barbecuing. But when he's not barbecuing, he spends lots of time developing this code. And the animation that's playing here was put together by Raqib Hassan, one of our PhD students now at Geoscience Australia. And you see this animation highlights two different views, how all these blue elements, they're the subducting slabs, they're recycled plates from the surface falling back towards the core mantle boundary. And in response, we get all these spiky little plumes upwelling. So this actually makes the Earth look like a punk hairdo or something like that. It's quite interesting. And so this is the first step in our experimental planet. We are now going to hook up our plate tectonic engine, G-plates, to CIPCOMS to model the stirring of the mantle, and the stirring is driven by the patterns of plate subduction through time. And the main output that we are interested in for the moment being is how these processes together might modulate surface topography. And so that's what we're going to have a look at in a minute. And so for these models, we need a high-performance computer. There's more than 10 million data points involved. One single model that will run over, say, a mere 200 million years geological time will consume 40,000 CPU hours and run for many days on several hundred CPUs on the computer. So we are now going to do a bit of open heart surgery on the earth. And we have run our experimental planet model, and we're going to have a look inside. We are doing this by actually importing the output of these models back into our G-Plate software. And so we are now going to have a look how the continents move over the convecting mantle. And so what's shown here, so you recognize Australia and Antarctica down here. The red object in the middle is the core, or hot upwellings associated with the core. The bluish colors all represent subducted slabs where old plates are being recycled back into the mantle. Now this was a time, 140 million years ago, when a long-lived subduction zone had existed east of Australia, like we see it along most of the circumference of the Pacific. And so this was a time when New South Wales would have been subject to frequent earthquakes and volcanic eruptions, much different to today. And so this had been going on for hundreds of millions of years. And so there was this wall of slab material that had been recycled over the eons previously, which is the time that we start looking at this model here in the early Cretaceous, because we started this time because we tried to understand how Australia got flooded in the Cretaceous period a little bit later when those ichthyosaurs were swimming around in this inland sea. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to have a look how this model evolves through time. And the first thing that you'll note is that and you watch the time on the upper left there, geological age. And what will happen is that Australia will start moving to the east together with Antarctica. And so this continues until a bit after 100 million years ago. And you can immediately, very visually, see here that the slab wall, we call this also a slab burial ground, is now located underneath eastern Australia. And you have to imagine this is an immense volume of material that's dense, that's sinking in the mantle, and it's drawing, it's sucking the surface down. And this is ultimately the process that resulted in large parts of eastern Australia being flooded at this time. Now, after Australia completed this eastward journey that was related to the early opening of the Indian Ocean, which of course didn't exist when the supercontinent Pangaea still existed. Australia subsequently lazily sat around in the same spot without doing a lot, while the Tasman Sea started forming and breakup between Australia and Antarctica happened. Finally, after about 45 million years ago, Australia started its fast northward journey at speeds of about up to 7 centimeters per year, that changed again very much its relationship with the convecting mantle underneath. And what you notice now is that the eastern part of Australia starts spreading this red hot upwelling on the right hand side, and so that ultimately results in eastern Australia being pushed up again. In the north, you will now see that northern Australia has started overriding what we call the Southeast Asian slab burial ground. This is another place where a lot of recycling of surface plates has occurred, and northern Australia is being drawn down now. So if we now have a look at the dynamic topography that comes out of these models, right? And so that's what we are playing here. So the red and the blue colors again represent uplift versus subsidence. The two large red areas are areas of very large-scale upward-directed flow in the mantle, and that happens in a response to all the plate material that's being subducted. For everything that goes down, something has to come up because of preservation of mass. And of course, where it comes up is far away from the places where things go down. Right? So we end up partitioning the Earth into these two giant upwellings, and from this perspective, we're one strip of downwelling material. Right? And so what's interesting about this animation is having a look at how Australia has changed its position relative to this large-scale pattern, which hasn't really changed all that much in the last 150 million years. And we have time playing here again on the upper left. So these two large upwellings are also termed the Pacific Superswell and the African Superswell. And after watching this a few times, you notice that when it starts out, Australia actually straddles the African Superswell namely Western Australia. And of course, Western Australia is being pushed up at that time. But then Australia moves to the east, overrides the slab burial ground, it gets drawn down. But then subduction, this long-lived subduction along Eastern Australia comes to a grinding halt at around 100 million years ago. So that's when this slab burial ground loses its connection to the surface and all these slabs just gently sink into the deepest mantle without being connected to the surface anymore. And Australia then has a chance to rebound, to come back up. And that motion actually constitutes the initial formation of the Eastern Highlands. Then, of course, Australia continues its northward motion. Ends up straddling the Pacific superswell, and its easternmost edge of the Australian continent ends up straddling the superswell and it gets uplifted again. And so, so if you look at Australia's topography, it's a slightly unusual view of Australia from the north that today results from all these processes. Is we realize that northern Australia actually represents a drowned coastline. So this is a coastline. So there's a shallow sea that covers much of the area north of Australia, and that all used to be exposed, right? And this area has become flooded only because northern Australia is overriding this giant slab burial ground that has drawn Australia down and has resulted in the Gulf of Carpentaria and other regions here to be flooded, right? So in contrast, the Eastern Highlands have experienced the exact opposite motion. Because here, Australia is now straddling this Pacific upwelling and it's being pushed up. And so the topography of Australia can be entirely understood by means of the interaction of its plate motion with the underlying mantle. So now we're going to move on to the next element of our experimental planet. And so that concerns surface process models. So now we are interested in finding out how erosion and sedimentation has modulated Australia's topography, and that is in the first place driven by these very deep-seated forces. So we do this using the Badlands software, that's the third open source community code that we're using. It was developed by Tristan Sal, seen here with glass of champagne, celebrating his recent success in the Artemis Grand Challenge, getting access to a whole bunch of CPU hours on the Artemis supercomputer to run these sorts of models. And so this software will allow us to now model surface processes. And there are many reasons why we are interested in that. And one of these reasons that I want to go back to now is the connection between plate tectonics, erosion, and habitability of our planet. And so there's two distinct connections there. Because first of all, most volcanism occurs along plate boundaries. And of course, there's volcanism associated with the subduction zones especially, and that produces greenhouse gases. So all these volcanoes that you find along the Pacific Ring of Fire, they spew quite a lot of CO2 out into the atmosphere. And so plate tectonics does play a role in the first place in creating an atmosphere that contributes to making the planet habitable. But there's a sort of seesaw process going on between ice house and greenhouse climates, and the planet has set itself up to have a mechanism to make sure that these processes ultimately don't sort of form runaway processes. So plate tectonics forms mountains, right? And in these mountains, CO2 dissolved in rainwater will react with silicate minerals, and new minerals will be formed, and CO2 will be consumed. And so, while other tectonic processes end up spewing out CO2 into the atmosphere, mountain building contributes to drawing down CO2. So if the Earth gets too hot, high levels of rainfall and erosion will start bringing CO2 levels down, whereas if the Earth gets too cold and freezes over, then volcanism will make sure that there's enough supply of greenhouse gases to take it out of the ice age. So, plate tectonics plays an interesting role in this fashion in making sure that over long geological times the Earth remains habitable. So this is our next experimental planet workflow where we are connecting up G plates with our Sitka Mathematical Collection code and surface processes, and to have a look what we can say about Australia's evolution through time in more detail than before, actually looking at river systems through time. and where sediment has gone to. And so this is now the output of a Badlands model that is driven by tectonic forcing from below. We're having a look how erosion, what sort of damage erosion does to the land surface through time. And so we're going to have a look at an animation now that was put together by Tristan, and was published in a paper by Tristan and Nicolas Flamand, who is now at the University of Wollongong, and myself earlier this year, where we have created sort of our initial model. This was really the prototype of this extension of our experimental planet that tries to explain how Australia's topography has evolved over the last 150 million years. And we need to watch this two or three times to capture all the different bits and pieces. So in the beginning, you'll see that Western Australia was strongly uplifted. Now, this is because Western Australia was located close to this African superstrat at the time. And we are showing this in a fixed Australian reference frame, even though we know Australia has moved around, just for convenience, so it's easier to see the changes that have happened here. Now, so as time goes by, we form an inland sea in this model. The inland sea disappears. And the Eastern Highlands start forming in two phases. First, the rebound from the inland sea, where all the subducted slabs disappear into the lower mantle and stop drawing the surface down. So Australia comes back up like a giant wobble board. And later, maybe in the last 20 to 30 million years, there's the second phase of uplift of the Eastern Highlands. That's due to Eastern Australia moving to the northeast and coming within the reach of the South Pacific superstrat. Now, if we watch this one last time, you will notice that the initial river systems, the prototypical Murray River, if you like, actually drained into the Tasman Sea. And it did that because it could, because there were no Eastern Highlands in the way to stop it from doing that. But as soon as the Eastern Highlands start forming, we start forming river systems in this model that end up looking very much like the observed Murray-Darling Lachlan river systems, and I try to convince you of that in a minute. So this is our model in four steps. And there was one particular aspect of this model that we were not very happy with. And this is, this was the first go we had at modeling Australia's topography through time. Our model, synthetic inland sea, the Erromanga Sea, was actually connected to the Southern Ocean, and we know this is wrong. Because from geological data, we know that it should actually be connected to the sea towards North Australia. And so this year, we set up a research project to try to come up with a more sophisticated model. And that's the honest project of Lauren Harrington, who's also in the audience. And here's Lauren. And this is her much improved model that she has produced for her honors thesis, soon to be submitted. And you see that in this model, the Erromanga Sea forms in a much more realistic fashion. And if we watch this again, we will see how it forms and ends up draining to the north as an ephemeral inland sea and disappears with the Eastern Highlands forming subsequently. And so this was achieved by many subtle changes to this model that combined tectonic and dynamic topography. Now we're going to have a look at the river systems that our model produces. So that's the observed Murray-Darling river system on the left-hand side. And these are our model rivers. We think they look pretty similar. And we're pretty happy with that because we didn't impose the production of these rivers in this way. They actually naturally emerged in our model in a fairly realistic fashion. And we think that's a good sign that most of the ingredients in our model are okay, and that it's not all that half-baked. If we look at the observed topography of the Snowy Mountains, that's shown here on the right-hand side, there's Cape Howe. And if we look at our model topography, our synthetic Snowy Mountains, if you like, again, we think, well, that's pretty similar. We are pretty happy that we are able to reproduce Earth's topography that comes out of the model that runs for 150 million years. And the cumulative effect of all tectonic and surface processes that have acted on this model end up producing what we observe to a fairly accurate degree. So we are happy with that, and we think this puts us in a position to actually start modeling the future. Because ultimately, that's one of our aims, to try to model future coastline evolution. And that's of course relevant for coastal management, climate change adaptation, insurance, you name it. And so now I will show you one animation that was created by Kyle Mandy, from the, who's an undergraduate student from the University of Colorado, who's working with Tristan and myself. So they've used a high resolution elevation model, both onshore and offshore, to model the future of tree heads. And we've focused on this area because it shows some particularly interesting phenomena as we project the future world all the way into 2500. So if we look at IPCC reports, then we'll find that sea level might rise by 1 meter by the year 2100. Now this is for the so-called business as usual scenario, where we don't manage to cut greenhouse gases a hell of a lot. Now if we do a better job, then of course sea level will rise less. And that remains to be seen. But of course we will be able to explore all these different scenarios with the Badland software. Now by 2500, sea level would have risen by up to 12 meters, mostly due to melting of the Western Arctic ice sheet, while mean precipitation in this region also is expected to increase moderately. And so now what we're going to do, we're going to use these boundary conditions to see what's going to happen to this area over the next few hundreds of years. And we show three different views of this. On the left-hand side here, we just show elevation through time. On the right-hand side here, we show river discharge through time. And so the more hot red these colors are, or the bright red, I should say, the larger the river discharge, right? Down below here, we show erosion and deposition change in meters. So as the erosion tends to flatten the landscape to some extent, and then we transport a lot of sediments out here towards the coast. And because we have Tweed volcano in this region that's made up of basalt, there's Mount Warning here in the middle. That's material that is relatively easily erodible. And first we're going to have a look at, so this is the Tweed River here. You can see it, and at present the Tweed River drains into a narrow estuary. But only a few tens of years need to go by, so we wait until the year 2100. And there's so much sediment being eroded. There's so much sediment aggradation happening in the Tweed River, and that the landscape gets flattened to such a degree that it will try to find a more efficient way to reach the sea. And so this Tweed River, it will oscillate back and forth a few times until it finds a better position to drain to the sea, which ends up being much further south. So north is to the right, south is to the left. And so the Tweed River initially ends up here, and we find a bit of sediment deposition in orange here, but then it switches and we get a large delta forming offshore this area where there's no sediment deposition at all. But interestingly, a lot of the sediment doesn't even make it into the ocean. Right? We get a lot of sediment deposition on the floodplains here as well. Right? And as a consequence of all this extra sediment that's being deposited in this area while sea level is rising, we form a large set of inland lakes that cannot connect to the sea because of all this extra material that's being deposited that's in the way here. Right? And so the interplay of sea level rise, erosion, and sedimentation plays an interesting role in how this coastal landscape will actually evolve through time. And here we form a large embayment where we have an estuary at the moment. Of course, the Badland software will allow us to explore all sorts of different scenarios as there's uncertainty across how precipitation or sea level rise might exactly unfold over the next few hundreds of years. Now, what does the future hold for our experimental planet? One of the elements that we're going to add to our experimental planet starting next year is a model for ocean circulation, paleoclimate, and rainfall through deep time. And so this is based on software that we're developing that's nearly ready for showtime. It's called the Atom Code. That's a collaboration between our group and Roger Goldman from the University of Dresden in Germany. And what's shown here is a reconstruction of the Earth's topography 42 million years ago. And these are ocean surface, ocean streamlines at this time. So we're going to be able to model with this relatively fast code ocean circulation and atmospheric circulation all the way through deep time. Now, most importantly, What our plan is to connect these complex data and models that we have with many dimensions over many time scales to emerging statistical methods to evaluate uncertainty. Of course, projecting or understanding how the Earth has evolved in the past or into the future is inherently uncertain. There's many parameters where we don't know exactly what they were in the past or what they will be in the future. So we will need new tools to actually evaluate uncertainty in these models and simulations. And so our plan is to go back perhaps up to 2 billion years into the past, and there's an animation shown here by Andrew Meredith that shows how the Earth might have evolved over the last billion years. That would be our boundary condition for our deep time models. But we'll also try to model the future, as I've just shown you before. And in order to do that, of course, Sydney University has created two important entities, the Center for Translational Data Science, that's led by Sally Cripps and Fabio Ramos. And its sister organization is the Sydney Informatics Hub, that's led by Graham Lewis from physics and myself. So the Sydney Informatics Hub provides research engineers to help in implementing cutting-edge ideas for how to use statistical tools in connection with these models. So of course none of this would be possible without the awesome Earthbyte group. And I hope I haven't left anybody out here. And there's my colleague Patrice Ray, shown here in the middle, inspecting an opal outcrop somewhere in Queensland, who's founded the Earthbyte group with me. And my last slide gives you a few tips for resources in case you're interested in building your own virtual planet at home. A good starting point is our Earthbyte group webpage that points you to many resources, in particular the Gplate software, the SimpleMesh software, and the Badlands software, our three current components to link the deep Earth to the surface. But then we also have a Gplate portal for interactive virtual globes, and for that you need nothing else than a web browser, where you can explore some of our published models for the Earth, both at present and in the past. And lastly, I'd like to thank the Australian Research Council, the National Computational Infrastructure, and also the AusCope National Collaborative Research Infrastructure, without whom none of this would have been possible. But especially, I would also like to thank the University of Sydney, and my special thanks go to the research development team, Andrew Black, Jenny Turner, and Rui, who have supported us over many years to pull all these different grants together. And I'd also like to thank especially Jeremy Hammond, who is a brilliant mind and who's been able to string together the digital infrastructure that enables the University of Sydney to do this type of research. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deepma, for that very informative and fascinating talk. I'm sure we'll listen to lots of questions. We have a few minutes for questions. We have some roving mics here, so first question in front here. Thank you.
Thank you. Your simulation of the continental drift appeared to show the South Pole, or at least where the meridians combined, always in Antarctica. Does that mean that the axis of the Earth, Antarctica was always on the axis of the Earth rotation?
Not always. If you go far enough back in time, then you would see that Antarctica has in fact moved. But during the fragmentation of Pangaea in the last 200 million years, a mere blip in geological time, Antarctica has always been close to the South Pole, yes.
And does the Earth's rotation inject energy into the convection, or is it not coupled?
No, it's not coupled. That was one of the early mistakes that Alfred Wegener made when he had suggested continental drift. And he had suggested something called the pole Fluchtkraft. He had suggested that the Earth's rotation is in fact responsible for moving the continents around, and then geophysics has proved that didn't work. And that was one of the main reasons why his theory was canned at the time. It took many decades for us to develop plate tectonics theory afterwards.
Okay, looking for the questions down the front there in the middle. Thank you. If anybody else has questions, put your hand up so I can spot them.
Thanks very much for your lecture.
When you develop these computational models, do you initially run them backwards? Because obviously we know what all our information is at the present.
So there are complementary approaches underway. Some research groups have developed approaches, so-called adjoint models, that combine backwards and forward models. The main reason why we have focused on forward models is that we are interested in going quite far back in time. The further you go back in time, the less information is contained in the current structure of the Earth. So the backwards or combined backwards and forwards models are useful, particularly if you are merely trying to go back a few tens of millions of years, perhaps up to 70, sort of the golden rule. And beyond 70, it becomes more difficult to actually make use of the information in the matter today.
Right. Okay, we have a question at the back over there first.
I just wanted to find out about the the African superplume, would that be how you call it? And so there's the African one, and that's causing that Rift Valley to happen, which is very dramatic.
Yes.
But what about the Pacific one? Like, where is that coming to the Earth, or has it died? Or
No. It's alive and well, and it is less obvious because it's located under a large ocean basin. So, and of course, we are generally not so much aware of ocean bathymetry as we are aware of topography. But one of the things, one of the most noticeable signs of the existence of the Pacific superplume and superswell is in fact all the volcanism associated with it. I mean, this is, of course, in French Polynesia, you have lots of recent volcanoes and volcanic chains. And that they are all small, massive plumes, these cylindrical upwellings that are embedded in this very large scale upwelling. And if we do a careful analysis of the symmetry of the topography of the seafloor in the Pacific, we see that it is also enormously shallow. It's being pushed up to some extent by this superplume.
Great, thank you. Sorry, we have a question in the middle here.
Thank you. My short summary of your lecture is wow. I was intrigued with your comment that the Earth gets too hot, it'll cool itself down.
Yeah, so So
is that within the habitable temperature range or not?
Yeah, I mean that's what the evolution of life on Earth seems to indicate to us. So we have just in the last, say, 600 million years during which complex life has evolved, we have a sequence of hothouse and icehouse climates. They have never resulted in a sort of runaway effect, right? Because you might think, well, once you have a huge glaciation and much of the continent is covered by ice, you increase the albedo, the reflectivity of the surface, so that much of the sunlight gets reflected back into space as opposed to being absorbed by the continents. Without any regulating mechanism, you might think that the Earth would then eternally stay in an ice age. So these mechanisms, they ultimately ensure that the Earth returns back to a hot climate.
Even if we pump a lot of CO2 into the atmosphere,
will
it not run away?
Yeah, well, over geological time, it won't, you know. But that's going to be good enough for human survival, it remains to be seen, you know. Because, of course, there can be a very large, shorter-term fluctuations.
Yes, my habitable question.
Ultimately, I'm sure the Earth will remain habitable for life in general, you know. But what form of life will cope best, you know, that remains to be seen.
Thank you very much.
Any further questions? Thank you.
The models that you have based on like 100 million years, what kind of additional data do you need to be able to expand the model to the
2 billion year target. So for example, like there's fossil records, carbon dating and so on, I guess there's all that kind of data. But your model there was like 100 million years. What additional data do you need to build the model to that greater time frame? Thanks.
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Because fossils don't tell us too much beyond 600 million years ago, because there was only very primitive life forms back then. And so we depend very much more on the geological record of volcanism, for example, that tells us where subduction zones were located. They're always associated with volcanism, and a lot of it gets preserved. This gets accreted to continents, and it's part of the geological makeup of continents today. For example, if you take Australia, because the two-thirds of Australia is covered by a thick weathered layer of rock. And so one of the additional pieces of information that we actually need is we need to be able to see through this surface weathered layer and be able to better map the deeply buried geology. So because that's where information is hidden about ancient plate boundaries of the time when Australia still consisted of three or more continents that hadn't come together yet to form Australia as it is today. And so we need to be able to map out the ancient boundaries of the proto-continents that have existed before. And of course we can also, there's enough of a geological record to know which parts of the continents were flooded. So we have some idea of which continents were maybe located over mantle upwellings versus downwellings. And so we can perhaps use that record to try to arrange the plates relative to the mantle back through time.
Right. Okay, that's one last question, I think, just in there. That's the last one, just the time.
Great, thanks so much.
I've got one quick question. You mentioned that the sea level will rise over the next 100 years by 1 meter or something around that. And you also mentioned that we have all these forces, upward and downward forces for the plates of Australia.
Yes.
So do you expect that Australia will sink or Australia will get up within the next 100 years?
No, I think those deep-seated forces will not play a major role in these scenarios, because all these other processes, sea level rise and changes in precipitation, erosion, sediment deposition, will be far the effect will far outweigh any of these deep-seated effects. So over this relatively short geological time frame, they're not going to be that important. So in fact, just one last comment about your question. If you're close to an area where ice sheets exist today, say if you go to Antarctica and you were to melt a large portion of the ice sheet that's actually sitting on the continent, then there you will see the major change, not only because the ice is melting, but the unloading of this ice will in fact result in uplift, and how this uplift occurs, in fact, has something to do with how the continent is coupled to the viscous mantle and exactly how viscous it is and how fast it will come up. So in those places, those effects will play a role.
Thanks. Okay, let's finish it there. I have a few announcements to finish off, but the first one is ask you, please join me in thanking Professor Dietmar Müller for a very fascinating engagement. I'd also like to thank you people coming along tonight for your support of the Sydney Science Forum series, and also thank the organisers of the series for making the opportunity available. I think it's a wonderful thing and certainly like to see the ongoing support. You've seen a lot of high-tech data science here, but we've got a treat for you. We're going to find out how much you enjoyed this evening. So we have appropriate technology rather than high technology. On the way out, you pick up a card, and the card has got five colourful faces, and we're asking you just to rip off this slot there whether how much you enjoyed or otherwise this evening. So rather than data science and high tech, that's more appropriate technology. Please just put that in the box outside, and we'll get good feedback for us in terms of understanding the evening. Another way in that a number of people spent some time in the foyer and had a look at some of the materials and things that were out there, including the Magic Planet Projector. Please, after the talk, take some time and explore some of the materials. Talk to the very friendly staff and students at the School of Geosciences out there. They're very happy to talk about what they're doing and engage with you with questions. So please take the time to do that rather than just simply rushing home. And finally, we have some slides up here for the next presentations. So the next presentations, final two City Science Forums for 2017, they'll be held next month on the 18th of October out at Westmead. Associate Professor Dita Hoculi will present Life in the City. And then back here in Camperdown on the 25th of October, Dr. Alice Williamson will present Breaking Good. So once again, thank you very much for your support and all the best. Thank you.